Your Game Gear is going to die. And I'm not just talking about the batteries here. That's right, Sega's awesome handheld system from 1991 has a fatal flaw that will eventually cause every one of them to stop working. In this video, I'll be taking a look at a broken system and seeing what it takes to fix the Game Gear's biggest problem. Stay tuned. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. PCBWay offers all the services you need for prototyping and production of your electronic projects. With PCBWay, you can order a wide variety of circuit boards, including advanced multi-layer PCBs and even those cool flexible PCBs. You can even order your PCBs assembled so they're ready to use when they arrive at your door. Did you know that PCBWay can help with other parts of your project too? That's right, PCBWay now offers services for 3D printing, CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication, and even injection molding plastics. All of these services are available with fast turnaround times and competitive prices. For your next project, be sure to visit PCBWay.com for the easiest prototyping experience.
Mad Mod.
Today, we're going to take a look at this Game Gear that I purchased from eBay. You can tell by the rough exterior that this console has seen better days. The eBay listing clearly stated this console is for parts or repair only. Despite all the scuffs and scratches, I am pleased to see that this console is still in one piece. Let's add some batteries and a game and see what's going on. Well, the console does power on, but I have absolutely no picture on the screen. If I adjust the brightness wheel, I can kind of make out some different colors and some vertical lines on the screen from time to time. The state of the screen seems to be very inconsistent and usually lands on a shade of dark green. I just realized after increasing the volume, I don't have any audio either. It looks like the system is reading the game even though it's not displaying correctly, so I should probably have audio too. Symptoms like these definitely justify the console being sold as for parts or repairs only. Unfortunately, this state of operation is extremely common for used Game Gears. I have a pretty good idea what's going on here, so let's go ahead and take this system apart and see if we can fix it. I will start by removing the batteries. There is one of these large game bit screws in the cartridge slot of the Game Gear. There are six more screws that hold the system together. These just use a regular Phillips head. After removing all the screws, the Game Gear opens up from the bottom, hinging open like a book. This Game Gear looks pretty clean on the inside. Thankfully, there's no signs of battery corrosion like there are in some consoles. These little black boxes on the Game Gear's motherboard are called capacitors. The little black boxes are really just a plastic shell surrounding a typical electrolytic capacitor. These capacitors are an extremely common point of failure for the Sega Game Gear, due to their age and questionable quality. Thankfully, modern replacement options exist for these components. These capacitor enclosures are actually glued to the Game Gear's motherboard. Before they can be desoldered, they must be pried up using needle nose pliers or a set of tweezers like this. Now we can heat up the soldering iron to remove these capacitors. These capacitors can be removed by heating up the leads with a soldering iron. Here I am using a set of tweezers to lift the capacitors out of the Game Gear. Sometimes the capacitors are difficult to remove due to the electrolyte that has leaked out of the capacitors. Most of the time, this is easy to correct by cleaning the contacts and letting some new solder flow onto the pads. If you are attempting this same repair, I would definitely recommend removing the Game Gear's main board from the enclosure before desoldering. You must be very careful to not get the soldering iron too close to the plastic shell, or else it will melt. On this version of the Game Gear, the main board has 12 capacitors that will need to be replaced. Let's remove those right now. After removing all the old capacitors, it's easier to see the light corrosion that's left behind by these leaky caps. I'm going to go ahead and clean the board with some isopropyl alcohol. You can also dissolve some forms of corrosion with distilled white vinegar. These cotton swabs look pretty gross after cleaning off all that corrosion. For replacement capacitors, I will be going with ceramic capacitors. This particular kit is sold by Retro 6. Ceramic capacitors do not fail in the same way that electrolytic capacitors do. These caps should last much longer than a set of electrolytic ones. These tiny little caps are tricky to install, so I'm going to go ahead and remove the Game Gear's system board from the enclosure. I'm going to start off by installing the two 1 microfarad capacitors. Keeping these capacitors in place for soldering was a little difficult. I found a good method for installing the new capacitors is to add fresh solder to one side of the pads. Then hold the capacitor in place with a set of tweezers and allow the solder to flow from the pad to the capacitor. After this solder joint cools, you can easily add solder to the other side of the capacitor. This process must be repeated for each capacitor. Next, I will be installing 5 of the 10 microfarad capacitors. It's worth noting that this Retro 6 capacitor kit does not use the original capacitance values. Instead, it uses standard values like 100 microfarad, 10 microfarad, and 1 microfarad to replace the original ones. It is pretty cool that these ceramic capacitors are not polarized like a normal capacitor. You can install these in either direction and they will still work. Please enjoy the following montage while I finish soldering up these caps. Here's a look at the finished system board. I like how low profile these little ceramic capacitors are. Some of these solder pads were easier to reach than others, with the most difficult one probably being C68 up there in the leftmost corner. Up next, I'll take a look at the audio board. To remove the audio board, I will first have to remove the 4 screws from this metal plate. Then there's 2 more screws securing the audio board inside the Game Gear shell. The audio board has 5 capacitors. These capacitors are also prone to failure. The easiest way to remove surface mount capacitors like these is to just break them off. It's really easy to accidentally pull up PCB traces trying to remove surface mount components like this with a normal soldering iron. You can avoid PCB damage by pressing down on the capacitors and gently twisting them until the capacitor leads break. After removing the capacitors, the leads can be desoldered. I will be correcting the damaged solder pad by scraping off part of the solder mask to expose the trace leading to the damaged pad. This trace is wide enough and close enough to the other pad to act as a new contact for the replacement capacitor. Now I will give the PCB a quick cleaning. Now I can install the replacement capacitors. On the audio board, all 5 capacitors get replaced with a 100 microfarad cap. Here, I'll be using the same technique of adding some solder to one of the pads, flowing the solder onto one side of the capacitor using a set of tweezers, and then going back and adding more solder to the other contact. Here's a look at the audio board all fixed up. Now that that's out of the way, we can turn our attention to the power board. To fully service the Game Gear, we should also replace the power board capacitors. Even though the system was able to turn on, these capacitors are likely to fail in the future. Hold on just a second, someone's at the door. A package just arrived in the mail from Hoto Tools. They were kind enough to send over one of their premium electronic screwdriver kits. Let's go ahead and test this thing out now. I'll have a link in the video description if you would like to check out one of these for yourself. In addition to removing the 2 screws, you must also remove this black plastic cover. These capacitors can also go bad and cause the system to fail while powering on. Unlike the other components, the power board capacitors are through-hole. A desoldering tool makes removing through-hole components much easier. In this video, I'll be removing the capacitors using my soldering iron. I just added some fresh solder to the pads to help distribute the heat, before pulling the capacitor out. After removing the capacitors, I will clean up the solder pads using a solder wick. This board also needs a good cleaning. The Retro 6 cap kit includes standard electrolytic capacitors for the power board. The stripe on these capacitors corresponds with the negative lead. The negative side is designated in white on the PCB. Now the power board is ready to go. Let's reassemble the Game Gear and see if it works. I'll throw in one of my childhood favorites here to test it out. Hey, it works! Well, the audio seems nice and loud now. It looks like a new set of capacitors is just what the doctor ordered. The Sega Game Gear was one of the first portable systems I ever had as a kid, so I always loved saving another one from going in the trash. If you have an old Game Gear with the original capacitors in place, it's definitely worth your time to look into having them replaced. I actually have some big plans for this beaten up old Game Gear, so keep an eye out for the return of this system in my future videos. You don't want to miss what's coming up next. If you like electronic repair and restoration videos, be sure to like this video and subscribe to the YouTube channel. Leave a comment down below the video telling me what portable system you had as a kid. Was it a DS? Maybe a Game Boy Advance? Did anyone have the elusive Sega Nomad? I would love to know, so let me know. Big thank you to the viewers who have also came to visit me on my Twitch channel. You folks are always super fun to talk to. Thank you all very much for watching this video, and I will see you in the next one.